now about halfway through Mind Control Night, so hang on in there. In the last show, you would have seen me suggest the Seven of Hearts to that chap, and I'm sure you picked up on the gestures that I used to do that. In the next show, I do the same thing with the croupier, only more subtly.
I'd like to do this with you, Cher.
Notice how the placing of the four cards suggests a fifth, the number five, and how I use my hands, five fingers, to suggest the same number.
You don't know if I'm going for a straight or a flush or a high or a low card, you don't know, so you can't work it out. What I want you to do is to just let the image of a card come to you. You'll know that it feels right.
I should point out that I don't condone gambling of any sort, unless you can cheat very effectively and stack the odds at least 90% in your favour, which is essentially what I'm doing here. At home, if you're wearing a watch, cover it with your hand now. This won't work if you're wearing a digital watch. In fact, take it off and pop it in your shell suit pocket. You look at your watch on average every 20 minutes. That's 26,000 times a year. So you'd absolutely know whether or not your watch has ordinary numbers or Roman numerals or just dashes, wouldn't you? Can you tell without looking? Okay, have a look and check. And then cover it again. All right, you've just looked at your watch, so you know whether it's got a second hand or not, surely. And what about this? What's the exact time on the face? Memory tricks, amongst other things which I'll show you, have got me banned from a lot of casinos in this country. This is my most ambitious project so far. We got a casino's permission to go inside and secretly film. Neither the gamblers nor the croupiers know we're using hidden cameras and CCTV, and no one knows I'm in there to scam them. The object of blackjack is to get your cards to add up to a higher total than the dealer without going over 21.
16. Card 16, 17.
If you can keep track of the cards which have been dealt, you have the advantage of knowing if the remaining cards are of a useful value. As a child, I learned to do this with a single deck, but casinos shuffle four packs together and I have to keep track of the cards of three other players. And that's £150 to me, right there. As the game progresses, I'm following each player's hand and keeping track of each card that's dealt. Player 1 on the right gets a 10 to add to his queen, also worth 10, a total of 20. He won't take any more cards. Player 2 has 3, plus 2 is 5, another 3 makes 8, and a queen makes 18. He'll stop there. But look at mine. A 6 and a queen makes 16. If I take another, it can't be over a 5, or else I'll go over 21 and bust. Would you risk it? I've got a good sense of the deck by now, and I take it. It's a 4, and I'm on a very good 20. He gets an 8 and sticks on 18. The dealer has to beat my 20 to win. A 6, a 9, a 10 make 25. She's gone over 21 and busts, and I win the round. That's £300 to me now. And I keep playing like this until I feel the croupier gets suspicious.
It was amazing. Every hand he had 16, and it was either a 4 or a 5 each hand. He'd done a couple of thousand off my table. Never seen it happen before. I can't be that lucky, I don't know. That's just far too lucky.
Luck certainly helps, but here's exactly how I do it. In my mind, I'm in a sprawling Florentine house, and in that house is a series of memory rooms, each yielding information I've placed there to remember. When I play cards, I visit the card room on the top floor. In it, I have a collection of 52 objects, each with a mnemonic link to a playing card. The clock set at 7 in a dome, for example, represents the 7 of diamonds. To play this game of 4-deck blackjack, I've attached 3 stickers to each object. As cards are dealt on the table, I move quickly to the relevant object and remove a sticker. If a card comes up 4 times, I remove the object entirely. After a while, I can see at a glance which cards are left, and then I know when to play for high stakes. That's about now. I'm confident enough with the remaining cards to play for big money. The other players do well in this game. Player 1 gets 21, player 2 gets 18, player 4 to my left already has 20. I'm on 11, which means if I want, I can double my stake. But if I choose to double, then I only get one final card. Now with only 11, I'd need a very high card for this to be worth it. But if you never take a risk, you'd never win anything, and I have stacked the odds heavily in my favour. So I double, and that's now all my chips on a high card. £2,600. The most any other player has won at the table is £350.
He shouldn't have been getting the cards that he was. He should have been going over and losing his money, but he wasn't. If he'd been taking risks, then he would have lost as well as won, but he just won.
He won too regularly for it just to be there. So he was obviously doing something. But no, it wasn't luck.
I can see why he's banned from casinos. I think he'd be asked to leave politely. They couldn't afford to have someone like that in the casino.
Bob Matthews is a runner who has set 22 world records and was a pioneer of the Paralympics. Because he's blind, I know he'll unconsciously pay more attention to what he can hear, subtle shifts and inflections in my voice. I met him at Crystal Palace. Bob, very good to meet you. Thanks for taking the time out for this. Can I just ask you to verify from the start that we've set nothing up, that you've got really no idea what it is we're going to do?
I can say quite honestly that I haven't got the foggiest.
Perfect. I'm going to give you an envelope to hang on to. If I give you that in your left hand there, that's right. Perfect. If you can just hang on to that for me.
Yeah,
we'll
sure.
Come back to that later.
Right.
Now, you've achieved some fantastic stuff, and you've got a passion that has taken you all over the world. What I'd like you to do for me is to think of one place that you've been, nowhere where you think I might just guess, but somewhere that you have positive memories attached to. Somewhere you can think of?
Okay.
You got somewhere?
Yes.
Great. Now, I'm going to ask you to create a scenario in your mind, and I'll ask you some questions, and just answer those questions in the way that feels most natural as we do it. All right? So imagine for me that you're going out for the evening in this location that you're thinking of. All right?
Okay.
We will make it a romantic date. So the first question is this with wife or girlfriend? I mean, I'm going to write this down.
Okay, wife.
Wife. Fantastic. And we'll just home in on sort of one aspect of the evening. So you're sat somewhere with your wife. Are you indoors or outdoors?
Indoors.
Indoors. Inside. So we'll say this is a restaurant.
Okay.
All right. Are you drinking red wine or white wine?
Red.
Red. Now, as you're sat there, you're aware of a cat walking behind you. And as it walks behind you, it gives out a little purr.
All right.
Now tell me, what's the cuisine of the restaurant? What nationality?
Thai food.
Thai. Excellent. As you go in and sit down, the waiter comes over and takes your order. Now, it's a waiter, not a waitress. And as he walks away, you're aware of a specific piece of music playing in the background. Tell me what the music is.
Jazz.
Jazz. I'd also like you to be aware of an aroma in the restaurant. Now, this is something specific, and it could be coming from flowers or something from the kitchen. Tell me what it is that you can smell in this restaurant.
For some reason, I've got sandalwood.
Sandalwood?
Yeah.
Sandalwood it is. All right, do you walk home or get a taxi?
We'd get the taxi.
Do you arrive home before midnight or after?
Before.
And finally, will you tell me where all this is happening? What's the location?
It's in Hereford.
Hereford?
Yeah.
Anywhere in the world, you chose Hereford.
Yeah.
Nothing wrong with that.
Good memories for me.
I'm sure. Well, it sounds absolutely charming. Were you thinking a lot about the answers, or what was going on?
I was trying to give you what came into my mind first.
Okay. What I want you to do for me is to open up the envelope that you've been holding on to all this time.
Now.
Yep. I would like to show the camera that this really is genuinely sealed. Which,
yep.
If you feel,
I can verify that is sealed. Yep.
Genuinely sealed. If you undo that for me, this side up here.
Yep.
And take out what's in there for me. Got it?
Blimey, it's Braille.
Got it. Fantastic. Just read that out for us.
It says, Dear Bob, I'm writing this about an hour before I meet you. If we don't meet again, I'll always picture you and your wife. Blimey. And your wife enjoying a glass of red wine with your tie. While Jazz plays in the background, there is the aroma of candles in the air. As ever, you will take a taxi and be back at 11:30, as those nights in Hereford are not to be missed. Bloody hell! Only the candle was wrong. That's incredible.
Well, I knew what I was thinking of, but I was.
Yeah.
You went very specific with the sandalwood, but it was a sort of scented candles I had in mind. How do you feel?
I'm stunned. I mean, it's as if I'm. It's I don't know. It's like an out of body experience. It's like I'm in. I'm witnessing this from somewhere else. You know.
Yeah.
It's incredible.
And my wife says jokingly that I'm like an open book, but I didn't think I was that open.
Coming up after the break, I'll be back at the casino playing cards with the croupiers.
How he got through and thought of exactly how my mind was thinking was just amazing.
And I'll be pushing a man backwards through a market.
Think left, think right, think forward, backwards, where are we going?
6:30 a.m.
My techniques are concerned with reading signals from people. Tiny unconscious clues that betray their thoughts. I tend to see it like a game, and I went to Borough Market to show some people how to play it.
He guessed it virtually all the way around. I thought, and he just followed me trying to thought. Incredible.
Martin, is that right? Good to meet you. And Andrew.
Andrew, that's me.
Brilliant. And I want to show you something with these vegetables. It will freak you both out. Excellent. I need... Can I grab some of these? It's all right.
Yes.
Some parsley.
Carrot.
That's a squash, I take it. And what I can only describe as a cabbage.
That's it.
Four vegetables. All right, Martin, here's what you do. Without giving it away by looking, think of one of those. You got one? Hold out your hand for me. Excellent. And if you hold out your hand and take hold of his wrist there. Like that. All right. Martin. You're thinking of one of these objects. You've got a vegetable in mind.
Yep.
All right. Whichever one of these you're thinking of, you mentally guide him to it. Just think of it, direct him mentally in your mind to the one. You move your hand backwards and forwards, and just pay attention to what you can feel. Slowly. Slowly. Pay attention to what you feel in the hand. See which one he's thinking of. Take your time. Was that it? Fantastic. Isn't that bizarre?
I don't know, just a feeling. Well, we got it, didn't we? So it must have been something, wasn't it?
It's a Victorian parlour game, and what's happening is that you're giving off tiny signals, which you're able to pick up on, but you're barely aware of them. It just kind of feels right, isn't it?
Yeah.
And you can play this at home with people, and it's bizarre. Now, you can get very good at this. Let me show you. We'll get a whole load more stuff.
Potato.
Turn it. Courgette. Okay. Same thing again. Well, I want you to have one of these vegetables on your mind. Think of one now. Have you got one in your mind? Don't give it away by looking at anything. Just have one in your mind. All right, give me a hand. All right. Now relax your arm. Give me control of your arm. You thinking of one of these? Give me control of your arm. Relax your arm. You got one in your mind? Yep. What was that? It's a squash. Was that right?
Yeah.
That was it? Excellent.
That was impressive.
It was, yeah.
That was major league impressive. That's... Yeah. I thought it might take him a while, but, you know... Obviously, he's done it once or twice before.
After hours, I was eager to see if the casino experts would be remotely impressed with my card skills.
It's 1978. I'm 7 years old, sat in the playground with my best friend, Jamie Lawrence, and he's teaching me poker. Rather precociously. I remember I had four cards. I needed one more card to complete a fantastic hand, and I willed him to deal me that card from the deck. He handed me a card. I took it. I looked at it. It was the right one. And that was it. I became obsessed with card skills. At 16, I'm slipping underage into casinos, studying the croupiers. I learned to cut off specific amounts of cards from a deck, For example, if I wanted to cut off 15 cards, I would cut about there. Let's count them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15 cards. Took that a stage further, learnt to see how many cards the croupier cut off when she went to shuffle. So take a whole bunch off for me. Okay, that looks like 28 to me. Count them with me. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28. That's it. Now, the way I do that is quite interesting. I count the cards in pairs, right? You see, pairs of cards, not individual cards, when you look at the side of the deck. I batch the pairs into tens and the tens into 20s. So it's far more difficult to work with odd digits, all right? So tell me a number to cut off, but make both digits odd. In fact, don't even tell me, just think of it. Both digits odd. Are you thinking of a number?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, I'll go for that. What was the number you were thinking of?
17.
17. Doesn't look anything like 17, does it? But try counting these. Count them for me.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17.
17 cards, exactly. Superb. So then I started playing poker. And I learned to watch the hands of cards as they get shown at the end of a game, to memorize those cards, to keep track of their position as the decks are reassembled, so that now I have a mental photograph of large batches of those cards. Then, as the croupier shuffled, to follow the redistribution of those cards in the deck, which is not impossible. If you watch the shuffles and the cuts closely enough. So I should now be able to cut fairly accurately to any card you may choose to name. Julie, tell me a card.
Nine of clubs.
The nine of clubs. It would seem impossible to keep track of all those cards, let alone intuit the positions of the ones we didn't see. So I really just have to just reach in and just do this. Nine of spades.
Nine of clubs.
Nine of clubs, sorry. There. Am I close?
Absolutely spot on.
Good. Whew. I mentioned earlier on Jamie Lawrence, my best friend. I still have the four cards with me that I had on that day. And I kid you not, these are them. They've become something of a lucky charm. I'd like to do this with you, Cher. Okay. I'm going to tell you in my mind, I will scream at you what the card is that I need to complete this hand. Now, you've got no way of knowing. You don't know if I'm going for a straight or a flush or a high or a low card. You don't know, so you can't work it out. But what I want you to do is to just let the image of a card come to you. You'll know that it feels right. You won't need to guess. You won't need to work it out. Just look at me. When you think you know it, quick as you can, you pick up the deck, you run through, you take out the one card you feel is right, and you put it face down on the table. Look at me. Doesn't matter if you get it wrong. There's no pressure. How could you possibly know?
Okay.
Then let me see. Okay, one card. Now, I know when Jamie handed me that last card, I know it was just a coincidence. Because you grow up and you learn to be more realistic about these things.
I really do not know why I chose the five of clubs. It came to me straight away. Just five of clubs. Just, and there it was, and I can't believe it.
A little bit scary, so he knows exactly how I'm thinking and what I'm going to be thinking next.
I don't think he'd be allowed into our casino. He would be banned. He wouldn't be allowed to use the tables.
Now, let's try something more ambitious. Do you have, either you have a picture of your wife or kids or you got something on you? What have you got? This is your wife, I take it. What's her name?
Janet.
Janet. What I want you to do is to hide this picture of Janet somewhere in this market. We'll all go out the way so we can't see where you're going. Excellent. Off you go. Martin, well done. So you've hidden a photograph of your wife somewhere in this market.
Yep.
No one knows where that is apart from you, correct?
That's right.
You haven't told me, you haven't told anybody else?
No one.
Good. All right. And we're going to do the same thing again, except this time, it isn't just a few vegetables on a table, it is a photograph of your wife anywhere, anywhere in this fruit market.
That's right.
Okay. You've got to direct me in your mind where to go. You direct me in your mind where to go. You think left, you think right. Show me in your mind, direct me there. You're guiding me in your mind. Good. Now concentrate. Concentrate on the picture of your wife. See the picture clearly in your mind. What's your wife's name?
Janet.
Janet, that's right. Just see Janet in your mind. See the picture clearly. In fact, go back in your mind. Concentrate on the most strongest emotional memory you have of her, probably the day you got married. Do you remember the day you got married?
Yes.
Do you remember looking into her eyes that day?
Yep.
Good. Well, focus on that image of her there and see that, visualize that in your mind and take me there. That's how clearly I want you to see it as you guide me there now in your mind. Keep thinking left or right. We're coming up now to a junction. Be thinking left or right in your mind. Good. And see that image in your mind. See the wedding day in your mind. Like you've been married for about, what, 15 years?
That's right.
15 years exactly?
Well, very nearly.
Very nearly. 16 years. Think left or right. Where are we going? Think left, think right. Tell me where we're going. Think it in your mind. Think it in your mind. Think left, think right. Think forward, backwards. Where are we going? This way. Good. Good. See your wife clearly. So, 1980, what? 1985? Yeah, summer wedding. It's, what is it? A Saturday, June, July, June, I think. Is that right?
Yep.
June, 1985. See Janet in your mind, staring into your eyes. The day you got married. Good. See it that clearly. Take me there. Take me there now. Can you remember where it was? Don't say where. Can you remember where you got married? Can you remember the place?
Yep.
Yeah? Somewhere in the country, somewhere nice, somewhere around London. Essex, is that right? You got married in Essex, is that right?
Yep.
You got married in Essex,
yep.
Good. Good, and keep going. Keep going around. Where are we going? Where are we going? Just think left or right. Take me there. Guide me there. Guide me in your mind. Where are we going now? Left, right, this way. Good, keep going, keep going. And guests, you can see all the guests. Just be there in mind. See all the guests around you. See your wife. Look into your wife's eyes. Focus on that. See the guests around you, the guests at the wedding. Somebody come from a long way away? Any guests from a long way? Can you remember the person that came from the furthest way away?
Yes.
Yeah? Can you see that in your mind? Can you see his name? Can you see what he looks like? It's, what's that? Tom? Tim? Terry? Terry, is that right? Terry came all the way from long way away. Lancashire, Lincolnshire. Lincolnshire, is that right?
That's right.
Terry came all the way from Lincolnshire, your wedding.
Oh.
Good, concentrate, think left, right. Where are we going now? This way, back. Keep concentrating, concentrate, take me there. Keep going, faster, faster. Just do it, see it in your mind. Get closer, and be there. The taste of champagne, the guests around you, your wife staring at your wife, that we're getting close now, we're getting very close, good. Your wife that several years later you would take a photograph of, you would carry that photograph around in your wallet. Whoa, we're very close. And then one day, where are we? One day, you would take that photograph out of your wallet, think, and you would put it, hide it, in a fruit market where? There!
Sit.
Where are we? What's this?
There it is.
There it is.
Amazing.
Janet. It's all coming back to you now, isn't it?
Amazing. He was just pushing me exactly the right way. When I was thinking right, he was going right. Excellent. When I thought immediately behind the window, and he put his hand straight to it. He guessed people that came down to our wedding like 15 years ago just by me thinking about it. No one would ever know that except for like close family. Very impressive.
Feeling on a bit of a roll, I take my £2,600 from blackjack and place it on a single number on the roulette table. Little tip, always put your chips on 22. Two twos, 22. If it comes up, I'll get £93,600. Enough to buy a new suit and shoes.
Get up at 5 in the morning to push that man around the market. And the only reason why I do this job, my only motivation, is that I don't have to get up early. And I didn't even get a free apple. Bastards.